This is me now, calm and relaxed with my fully equipped Neovim. But it wasn't always like this. At school, my Vim teacher would ingrain into my brain every motion and its different combinations. I grew up, I joined the Neovim army, where my sergeant would yell at me to repeat all the commands I knew in alphabetical order. After leaving the army, I explored the jungles and met with the old Vim 5 tribes. Their leaders repeatedly taught me the same set of concepts. I knew these motions like the palm of my hand, and I used them day in and day out. But here's the thing, as I got deeper into the Neovim rabbit hole, I began to realize that there were moments where it just couldn't keep up with my ever-growing list of customization demands. I started tweaking my Neovim setup, adding plugins and customizing my key bindings. I thought I was making progress. I thought I was becoming a Neovim wizard. Little did I know there was a hidden gem out there, a plugin that could have saved me hours, days, maybe even weeks of painstaking customization. Meet Treesitter Text Objects. This plugin provides a whole new set of text objects that are more precise and flexible than the traditional ones. It does so by using the power of the Treesitter parser, which allows you to understand the syntax and the structure of your code. Let's go ahead and dive right in. If you have Treesitter installed, you probably already have text objects, so check it out. I already did and I wasn't aware of it. I'm going to review the defaults to begin with, and if you take a look at them in the configuration, obviously you can take mine or grab the defaults from the project on GitHub. You'll notice they're separated into a few segments, and we're going to start with select, which is our way of selecting a chunk of code based on some type of query that Treesitter does. The first of which is the concept of a function. So yes, I'm writing Go, and my function here can be copied with the F notion. I can V around function, and instead of doing that, just visually selecting the brackets, I can V around function or V in function or delete inside a function, change inside a function, anything that I want to do and I can do with other motions and other type of object, I can do to a function now. Now, that's pretty cool. Let's pause for 10 seconds for a motion recap. You can tell Vim to do an action somewhere to something. Common actions are visually marking, deleting, yanking, changing, things like that. Common areas are around and in, hence the inner and outer notions of text objects. And lastly, common things are words, paragraphs, or signs like quotes, brackets, and so on. This way, you can VAW to visually mark around a word, or CIP to change inside a paragraph, or even DI parentheses to delete inside a pair of parentheses. Some of these, specifically the pairs, work even if you're not inside an object. So you can CI curly bracket to change inside a pair of brackets, even if you stand before or above them. Try it yourself. Anyway, back to text objects. Another text object I can use is the parameter. So I'm not doing anything fancy here. I'm just writing a function that takes a parameter, and this allows me to V inside a parameter and just grab it. It's nothing useful at the moment. Wait till the end and I'll show you what else you can do with parameters outside of selecting them, and that'll be very, very, very powerful. The next text object is a very common one. This would be the classes. Golang doesn't particularly have classes. It's not really an object-oriented language, but it does have structs and it does have its own way of running OOP. So I'm using structs a lot in my code, and the ability to jump between classes and visually mark them, again, copy them, change inside them, is something very useful. If it wasn't clear until now, if you take a look at the configuration to the right, you have AC, which is around class for the outer, and in class for class.inner. You don't have outer and inner for any kind of object. Take a look at the documentation of what objects are relevant to the relevant language that you're using and what types of methods each object has. I just want to stress again, when we use big objects like in real code, this becomes far more powerful, and the ability to just select an entire object, delete it, or change inside it becomes a game changer. After we've seen what it can do, let's check the README for a second and see the different objects that are available from the get-go. So you have a built-in text object list, which can be assignments, blocks, comments, conditionals, functions, loops, things that we've looked at and things that we'll look at in a sec. Not everything is supported with every language. There are many languages, not only languages, also type of formats like Docker files, YAML, JSON, stuff like that. Let's go deeper and see what the queries mean and what you can actually do once you know what language you're going to use. So inside queries, if I go to Golang, There is a text objects file, and when I open that, I can see the different types that are already supported if I don't want to view the table. And I can see different things that I can do. By the way, this is your ground for extending and customizing the different configurations. More on that later. So I can see, again, different Go stuff that I can use, statement, loops, blocks, parameters. Let's take these and see how can we configure them within Neovim, within the configuration of text objects to use the rest. So the next bit that exists on GitHub but doesn't exist in my defaults would be conditionals. I've chosen I for that, which is if for me. If you're not already have something configured with bracket and I, that's really useful. That's how I understand it, because conditional starts with C, and C for me is changes. The next changes are swapped with brackets and C. So I'll just create some kind of conditional and let's see how it works. Yet another great object you may want to think of configuring is loops. I set it to L, as in a loop. Again, you choose your own thing, but when I set up a few loops, I can do the same motions and run around them. This is useful for not only jumping to them, but obviously making the same changes around the loop, inside the loop, etc. Lastly, if you're a heavy user of comments, especially the multi-line ones, you may wanna grab a comment.outer configuration. I use T for that, which stands for text. Don't know if it's the best thing, but that's what I have now. So if I'm writing comments, I can do the same thing. Do note that comment only have the outer method, so I can only wrap around a comment. So if I go to a one-liner, that's pretty straightforward. I can visually mark around one single line of comment. But if I have a multi-line now, having the ability to get the motions that manipulate the object becomes far more significant. Up until this point, we only talked about the select methods. Select is being able to do something around, in, etc. about objects. The next very useful thing is the ability to move. The motions that lets you scour around your code, move between paragraphs or different chunks. So there are different options here. You can see go next start, go to next end, go to previous start, etc., etc. Let's review what they can do for us. What you see to the right is the bare default. This is how the plugin is coming. And I'm gonna use that for a second just to show you the power of being able to jump between functions, for example. So maybe not the best choice in the world, but bracket and M lets me move between different brackets. Obviously, as you can see, I can move between the starts of them or the ends of them. Kind of reminding us the ability to move between words. I can use word like W to jump to the start of the next word, or E, end, to jump to the end of the next word. I can have the same thing with functions. I don't know if that's very useful. I can think of me just jumping between different chunks of functions. Maybe I don't care. And we can see later, if I don't really care what I'm doing, how I configure that. Again, the same thing works for classes. So if I have different types here, I can jump between them with the configuration of bracket bracket. You can see class.outer, and again, class.outer, different settings for go to next start or go to next end or previous end, etc. One useful bit of information is the ability to set regex rules. So if I'd set loop.star, this means everything that comes after loop, inner, outer, would be grabbed by bracket O. So you can see that happening here. The thing with that is that this is only set for go to next start. So yes, inner, outer would all go to the next start. What if I don't care about where I'm going, start, end, or I wanna go through the entire list of them? Go to start, then go to end, then go to the next start, and then go to the next end. Well, in this case, I can use go to next and go to previous, which just catches all. So let's do that with a conditional. Again, I'm using I for if in my case. If I do that and I just go to next, you can see me moving to the beginning of the statement, then the end of the statement, then the beginning of the function itself, and then the end of the scope. And that's then going to the next function and so on and so forth. I want to take you through another important set of rules you can set, which are called swaps, that lets you, well, swap between different objects. The defaults that are set are for parameters, and for a good reason. Let's see what this helps me with. If I have a function with two parameters to begin with, and I have A and B, going with leader A takes the parameter that I'm standing on to the next spot, or with leader capital A previously to the previous spot. This is only done with two parameters. Let's see what happens when I have three or four. So if I'm adding a boolean for C and I'm taking C backwards and backwards again, I can move it either forward or backwards. This is for three. If I add a fourth one, I can do the same and just move it up or down the list. For the clean coders out there who are listening, yes, we do not support functions with too many arguments. However, when you do have a list, even of three and large names or longer names that you want to swap, this becomes useful. Before you leave, remember that this is not the final list of things you can do. There's a huge list of built-in text objects and a huge list of supported languages. Even if you're just a Golang developer, you can probably use the bash scripts or the support of Docker containers or Docker files rather, and there are a lot of other syntaxes and useful types of objects that you can use. Beyond that, you can extend the system. The plugins allows you to create custom captures for inner and outer objects and just decide whatever wrapper you want. If you're inventing your own language or your own system or parser and you have a new set of objects you'd like to capture, or maybe you're using an existing language that doesn't have the specific object that you're looking for in order to make different motions, jumps, actions on, even swaps, you can create the captures and then configure whatever you want. It is very powerful. And I highly suggest you read the documentation, and if you need, and if you want, just customize it. And please do let me know in the comments if you did. I'd be really happy to hear fellow users do cool things with whatever they're able to configure. Thank you, and I'll see you on the next one.